I'm Professor Darth. I teach in the Languages and Cultures Department. I'm also director of the Forum for Latin American Studies, which is what gives me the privilege of introducing Dr. Jennifer Tobler. Being a literature and culture sort of person, it's usually hard for me to get too excited about economics. But when I first read about Dr. Tobler's research in an article in the New York Times a couple years ago, I realized that this is an exception. Dr. Tobler and her colleagues do what I think is consistently exciting work, work that helps make fundamental differences in the lives of real people in developing countries. They both facilitate economic development in poor developing communities at the most basic grassroots level, and they document the effects of programs and policies that promote development for these same people. Today, Dr. Tobler is going to talk about the Brazilian NGO Saúde Criança, or Child Health. But in fact, she's been involved directly and indirectly in numerous such organizations throughout Latin America and Africa from her first forays into public policy studies. These involvements in Latin America include providing expert guidance to both lenders and borrowers of microfinance credit in rural Chiapas, Mexico, and advising microfinance providers and clients in Haiti, particularly regarding the integration of health and nutrition programs with microfinance resources. Dr. Tobler is, in fact, an expert on myriad aspects of development at the level of individuals and communities in developing regions, particularly Latin America. These aspects include the question of individual property rights, the impact of foreign investment incentives, the repercussions of trade agreements, the effects of multilateral aid foreign aid, and the consequences of policymaking in favor of impoverished people. Add to this her rather impressive degree credentials from, I'm going to abbreviate here, from Yale, Harvard, Oxford, and her professional credentials with the Brookings Institution and Georgetown Public Policy Institute, where she now teaches. And you can understand some of the ingredients for becoming an expert on community development at the age of longer than me. So this is just a way of saying that Dr. Tobler has already amply demonstrated to us that we are privileged to listen to her. Please give a warm and welcome.
Thank you very much for having me, and tell me if you can't hear me. I'm trying to project a little bit, but there's a microphone if you need me to talk a little bit louder. So I'm really excited about being here, and I was told today that some of you were forced to be here, but it was really exciting to hear that a lot of you would be interested in thinking and talking about poverty and NGOs in places like Latin America and Africa, because it's not something that us outsiders would think of midshipmen. So it's really exciting to me to hear that you do this. It's also exciting because I tend to get really excited about my work and talk really quickly, and the great majority of my students at Georgetown are international students, and so I have to get forced to speak slowly, and I figure I don't have to do that here. So I can talk as quickly as I want to, which I'm very excited about. So I didn't realize how long we had for today, so I'm actually going to try to talk a little bit faster than normal, and I'm going to try to get through this so that there's some time for questions, right? So what I want to talk about today is a program that Dr. Garth actually pronounces a lot better than I do. So I pronounce it Saúde Criança, and you might just say Saudi Criança if you look at it. And so it actually just means child health, okay? And the organization was renamed for a long, funny story that if you want, I can tell you after. But what I want to do is give you a quick overview of this program and what they're trying to do and what they actually do. And then I'll talk really briefly. I can go into some more details on this if you want, you know, when we have some Q&A about why it's important to do an evaluation, right? And how it is that we actually structured our evaluation. So if we have any econ grad students out there, you might be a little bit more interested in this than everybody else. And we can save some of that for the questions. And then I'm going to tell you about the results of our evaluation and tell you a little bit more about our evaluation. And we have three different sets of results. And then I'll give you a quick summary. So the big thing is, what does Saúde Criança do, right? What does Saúde do? So basically, in the early 1990s, there was this woman named Vera Cordero, who's the head of the project and is still the head of the project. And she was a doctor in some of the public hospitals in Peru. In Brazil. And in a public hospital in Brazil is basically serving the poor. If you have any money and you live in Brazil, you're going to go to a private hospital. So she's a doctor in these public hospitals, and she sees the same children coming back over and over and over again with the same types of illnesses too. Some of them are terrible illnesses like cancer, but some of them just have some simple respiratory illnesses like bronchitis or something like that. And she sees that these kids keep coming back over and over and over again to these hospitals. And she sort of looked at it and she said, I don't think that just curing the actual disease is doing enough for these kids. Because not only is she seeing these kids come back over and over and over again, she's often seeing the children eventually die. She's seeing the children siblings come back with similar diseases, and she's seeing the family deteriorate basically in front of her eyes. And so the idea was that she wanted to break what she called this vicious cycle of poverty, right? And the idea, right, so where these families are basically living in misery because of these diseases that their children are getting. And the whole idea was, is there a way to break this cycle of poverty that these families are experiencing? And so she came up with something called a family action plan. And the idea was, maybe rather than just treating the sickness of the child, we want to treat the whole family. And they wanted to do it in 5 different aspects. So they wanted to look at the health, and not just the health of that child who's sick, right, but the health of the whole family, all of the children in the family, and hopefully the income earners as well. Can we get the family earning more income? Let's look at their houses. Is one of the reasons that they're getting some of these diseases because of the different aspects of the way these people are living? The education, and again, not just of that sick child, but the education of all of the children in the family. And finally, access to all of the different services that the Brazilian government provides. So the Brazilian government is actually very, very good at having social services to their citizens, but they don't give easy access to everyone. Most people don't know about a lot of these services. So one idea was, can we connect some of these people to these services and let them benefit from them? Right, so what are the admissions criteria? Well, number one, in order to get into Saúde, you have to have a sick child, right? If your child has some type of chronic, terminal, or simple infectious illness, you can get into the program. But you also have to be very poor, right? So basically, the average family income had to be under $365 a year, right? So your family basically has to be living on a dollar a day. Really no sense of possibility of social mobility, and the family had to have a desire to improve themselves, right? And so how do they do this? Well, they had individual visits with the families, usually the mother, and site visits. So they would go out to their homes to make sure that they really qualified for this program. And so how does the program actually work? Well, each family basically has an individual family action plan outlined for them. So they go through their 5 different steps, and they try to say, where does this particular family need the most help, and what do we need to give them within each of our 5 aspects of the program? Each family gets assessed monthly by a volunteer. And this is a really interesting aspect of the program. So these volunteers, if you guys watched the World Cup at all, and you know anything, hopefully you learned a little bit about Brazil, but there's huge income inequality in Brazil. And what you saw possibly when you were watching if you saw any of the sort of views of Rio, of the people watching on the beach, watching the soccer games on the beach in Rio, you would see that beach, right? Right in front of the beach are all of these really, really fancy condos that none of us could ever even hope to afford, okay? And then right behind it is a hilltop with a favela, one of the poorest places to live in the whole world, right? So everybody's mixed in all together there. And the volunteers come from the wealthiest families in Rio, and the people who are getting the services come from the poorest. So these volunteers come and meet with each mother of the family once a month. Then they follow each child and family for at least 2 years. So the average, I'll show you some of the statistics of the program, but the program is meant to last about 2 years. It can last longer, and I'll show you the sort of graduation criteria. So it can last longer if the family's not ready to graduate, but the program is meant to last about 2 years. Saúde carries, on average, a load of between 230 and 250 families per month. So this isn't a huge program. And they receive benefits until they achieve this very well-defined set of discharge statistics. So basically, what are they getting? They're getting a basic supply of food. So every once a month, the mother of the family shows up. It can be the father, but in most cases, it's just the mother who comes. They get medicine for their child, right? Because that public hospital often isn't giving the medicine, and these families can't afford it. So they get the medicine that their children need for the month. They get a packet of food, rice and beans and some other nutritional supplements. They get, when they first go out to their houses, they assess their houses to see if they need to do any work on that house to make sure that it's sort of a healthier place to live. And then they can get housing support. They get technical support, so they get psychological evaluations, nutritional and legal advice. They get to meet with a lawyer and talk about how they can get connected into that social service system. There's professionalization courses. So they talk to the mothers, they ask them if they're working, and if they're not, they say, well, what do you think that you'd like to do? And if the mother says, well, I've always wanted to be a hairdresser, they connect them into these courses. And then there's some additional support programs for them, right? And so basically each family is doing this monthly visit where they receive the support package. And then there are a series of discharge criteria, and I'll sort of go right there. It's probably a little bit too small for you to see, but basically in order to graduate, your child needs to be healthy again. But on top of that, they go and they check out your house. And they make sure that your house has a water filter, that the house is made of brick and has a cement floor, because most of these people are living in these sort of tin shacks in these favelas that they've built by themselves. You have to have the house has to have a ceiling and walls with no holes or cracks in it. Right, this may sound amazing to some of you, but most of these people are living in these houses with huge holes in them, right? There has to be a sewage system or some sort of latrine outside of the house. The house has to have a minimum of 2 rooms with a bathroom, a sink, and a shower in it. Oops, I went the wrong way, and now I have to go back this way. On top of that, so that child has to be cured of an illness, and none of their siblings can have a new illness. All children under 4 have to be in nursery school, and all children between 5 and 16 years of age need to be in school. All of their kids have to have necessary evacuations, and all of their legal documentation has to be updated. You have to do all of this in order to graduate from Saoji. You can leave if you want, if you don't have these things, but to be considered a graduate, this is what you have to have, and Saoji is going to help you get all of these things. Okay? So who are they serving? Well, again, a family that has a sick child, the great majority of their clients live well below the poverty line. 95% of them are female-headed households, meaning that there is no father in the picture. The majority of these families are black, and there's an average of 4 children in each family. Right, so why should we do an evaluation, right? So I just told you about this comprehensive package, right? And these really poor families. So why even evaluate it? It sounds great, looks like it's working. Why even bother going through an evaluation, right? Well, the truth is that as researchers, right, and policymakers, we're looking for ways to end poverty, right? If any of you are following the new UN Sustainable Goals Against Poverty, we're looking for ways to end poverty. And there's tons of programs out there that make these huge claims about what they're doing and how they're ending poverty, but unless we really evaluate them, we don't know if it really works, right? And in sort of development economics, we like to think of it a little bit like medicine, right? So some pharmaceutical company comes up with a new pill and they say, this is going to cure cancer, right? We just have to give it to everybody. But we don't just give it to everybody, right? We sort of randomly decide who's going to get this pill, and then we watch what happens to the treatment group that got it and the control group that didn't, and we can actually see if that pill works. And so that's what we're trying to do with these evaluations. We're trying to figure out if this program actually works, or if it was just something that was going on that made the program work really well. On top of that, an evaluation was urgent because Saoji was expanding rapidly. They already had 17 replication projects throughout the country. They were going to standardize these replication programs, and they were trying to establish a program in every single public hospital in the entire country. There are also a bunch of government programs that were replicating this exact package. And so we really needed to be able to say, is this effective, and what is it most effective at doing? And so that's what we wanted to do here, right? So what was our objective? Well, we wanted to look at not just the short-term outcomes of this project. We didn't just want to know how are they doing when they leave that project. We want to know if 2, 3, 4, 5 years on, they're still doing as well as they were doing when they left that project, right? And basically, we want to know, are these families better off when they leave than had they not had this project? Because if they weren't, then why spend all of this money on this program, right? In addition to that, we really want to know in which aspects are they having more of an impact, right? So there are five different aspects to this program. Are they better at health than, say, housing, right? And so maybe since it's an expensive program, they should focus in on one particular aspect of the program, right? So what we want to do, right, is we want to basically do an evaluation that looks at all five aspects of their program: health, housing, education, income, and citizenship. Okay, and so just to give you an idea of what their families looked like, we had some basic information on all of the Saoji families that had graduated between 2005 and 2011, okay? On average, the kids had been hospitalized for 33 days throughout that program. They had an average of two hospitalizations. They were 4 years old when they entered the program, and they spent on average 2 years as part of the program. So that's what the sort of group of kids that we want to look at looks like. And what kind of diseases did they have? It's sort of important to know this, right? So the great majority of them had respiratory illnesses, right? So this can mean anything from bronchitis to pneumonia to sort of a lung tumor, right? We also had cases of digestive illnesses, basic infections, and things like cancer and tuberculosis, and sort of more difficult illnesses to cure, right? But they were all over the place, but the great majority were these respiratory illnesses, okay? So the first thing that we wanted to do was to just look at these Saoji families and look at them before they started the program, after they started the program, and then look at where they are today, right? And that's going to give us our first inkling as to whether or not this program is working. So again, we're going to look at the five different aspects of the program. So the first thing that we looked at was health, right? Now, this is kind of a given, because in order to graduate the program, the kid's not supposed to be sick anymore. But what this shows is, before they started in Saoji Crianza, the main child that we were looking at was hospitalized an average of 61 days per year. When they left Saoji, they were hospitalized an average of 9 days per year, right? So, okay, they're not supposed to graduate until they're not sick anymore, but this says something about the way that the program works, okay? In terms of housing, and I have tons more results, but because I want to have a little bit of time for us to have a conversation, we can go into some more results at the end. So this is looking at housing, and again, we're grouping this into before Saoji Crianza, when they graduate, and then today when we interview them, okay? And what this is looking at is the blue line is whether their house is rented. The red is it's family property, so it's owned, but they're still paying it off, so this is sort of like a mortgage. And the green line is that they own outright their own house, okay? And this is huge, right? So before Saoji Crianza, 26% of them owned their own homes. After Saoji Crianza, about 50% of them own their own homes. And that's a really big deal, right? And not only is that a big deal, so 26% owned before, 30% owned when they left, and then 2, 3, 4, 5 years later, they had this huge increase, right? What does this mean? It means the effects of this program don't just fall away afterwards, they endure for a number of years afterwards. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about who's in this sample in a second. Right, so what about education, okay? So this is enrollment. Before Saoji Crianza, zero of the kids are enrolled in school. And it's not because they're 4 years old, it's because they're all sick, right? So they're missing so many days of school from being in the hospital that they basically have an average education of zero, right? When they leave Saoji Crianza, that moves up to 93% of them are in school, right? And two to five years later, it's at 92%, right? So very little difference there. Again, it really means that the program is doing a lot and the program is enduring for a long time. What about in terms of income? So this is basically whether or not anyone in the family, 15 years or older, who wants to be employed, right? So if you're 15 years old and you're in school, we're not gonna count you in this, is actually employed. And again, we see this nice increase over time, right? So there's 53% employment when they start the program, and when they graduate, it moves up to 62% and up to 70% a number of years later, right? These are really sort of pretty drastic results. And this is per capita income, right? And so here, per capita income in the family was 117, and this is in Brazilian real. It was 117 when they entered, moving up to 251 today, right? And that's a big difference. And again, this is per capita. So that 251 means that they're living above that poverty line of $1 a day. Okay, and this is just household income, right? So that was the last was per capita. This is the whole household's income, where we see a move from 464 real for the whole house up to over 1,000. Okay, and that's about 250 U.S. dollars. Yeah.
Ma'am, is that per month?
That's per year.
Per year.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so what else? So this is interesting, right? But you also sort of want to spread it out. So we're able to look at these a bunch of families that are 2 years out, 3 years out, 4 years out, and 5 years out. And so we wanted to spread out some of these income differences to find out, you know, is it just this average? Is it that they shoot up right after the program and then it comes down afterwards? And so what this slide looks at is before Saúde Criança at graduation, and then we have 0 to 1 years out, 2 to 3 years out, and 4 to 5 years out, right? So it's that last graph spread out by how many years out of the program you are, right? So we see that there's this nice increase, and then there's a little decrease sort of the farther out you go, which makes us sort of worry a little bit about just how long the program is going to endure. And do we need to get back in touch with them maybe a couple of years out? Not too worried, because it's not a huge dip, but it's something for us to think about, right? Okay, and finally, citizenship. So this is just the percentage of families that are receiving Social Security benefits from the government, and it moves from about 7% to about 21%, right? And not everyone is eligible for these benefits. And that last slide was just about the number of women who are receiving alimony support, right? So 95% of the families are female-headed, and so we want them to get some alimony from the fathers, and that last slide was just looking at that. So now I've got a whole bunch of slides on the importance of impact evaluation. Right, so I started talking to you about, you know, thinking about this like medicine and seeing if it really works, right? So what we just looked at was basically looking at, sorry, I'm going to keep doing that the whole time, I bet, right? So right, what we were looking at there was before, after, today. And I say today, but it's almost 2 years ago now that we actually did the evaluation, right? And that's great, right? And these results are stunning. And when we showed this to the people at Saúde Criança, they were like, great, stop what you're doing. Now we have evidence that it works, right? And maybe that's true, right? Maybe this program does work, right? We saw these huge increases, right, in income, in whether or not they own their houses. It's really quite stunning. But we don't know, you know, maybe everybody in Brazil is doing better today, right? Maybe it's just Rio, right? Maybe everybody in Rio is doing better. Maybe the people who were in our study all lived in the same area, and somebody came and just gave them a ton of stuff, and so everybody in their area is doing better. We don't know that all of these increases, we can't attribute all of these increases just to that program. And that's what we really want to do. We want to be able to say all of this beneficial stuff that we see happening to these people is attributable just to this program, okay? So how can we possibly do that? Well, it's a nearly impossible task, and we failed a little bit, but we got pretty close to it, and I'll tell you about that, right? So the key is, right, in order for us to be able to do that, we have to find a group of people who look just like these families that Saúde treated. So they have to look just like them, but didn't get the treatment, right? So ideally, right, a development economist would have a time machine, right? So these families would, the kids would get sick, they would enter Saúde Criança, they would get treated, we would note how well they did, and then we would reverse time, okay? And we would run it again, and we wouldn't give them Saúde this time. We would get the outcome 4 or 5 years later, and we would compare these two groups, okay? We don't have a time machine, okay? So instead, right, we want to be able to find, and that group, right, that time machine group is our counterfactual. And whether or not we can say whether the benefits that these people received are attributable only to this program depends on whether we can really find that counterfactual group or not. Okay? And so what I'm getting at basically is this idea of we have this population, right? And that population, if we randomly select into two groups, right? So if a bunch of people randomly went into group A and another group randomly went into group B, and we give group A we let them enter Saúde Criança and we didn't let group B enter, we could then let the program happen, right? We could compare the two groups afterwards, and we would be able to say any differences between these two groups are purely attributable to this program, okay? Now, so we went to Saúde Criança and we said, okay, when a family shows up, okay, so they get referred by doctors in this hospital, when a family shows up at your door and they've been referred to you and you think they qualify for the program, we want you to flip a coin. If it lands on heads, they get to come into the program. If it lands on tails, they don't get access to the program. And they laughed at us, Okay. And why did they laugh at us? They said, our job is to serve this community, right? And if a family comes to us and the child has cancer and they need our help and they need medicine and they need food and they need help making their house better, we're not going to send them away because they came, their coin landed on tails, right? So there was no way they were going to allow us to do this, okay? And we felt bad about even suggesting it, right? But we pushed anyway. We said, we told them, you know, think about it as medicine, right? We won't know if this medicine works. And they said, no, figure something else out, okay? So we wanted to figure something else out, right? We wanted to figure out, right? And the problem was, too, so one thought we had was, well, what if we just looked at all the other kids at the hospital, right, at this same public hospital who didn't get the program, right? And so we could just compare that Saoji Crianza group to this group from the hospital, right? The problem is, so the red dots and the dark dots are basically poverty, and the yellow dots are basically wealth, right, or not so poor, right? We're really talking about poor and not so poor here. The problem is, these groups are selecting into this, and they're either selecting into it because they're really poor, because their child is really sick, or because the mother has something about her that says, I don't just want my kid to get better, I want to improve my whole family, and I'm willing to make this trip in to this hospital, to this organization every month and do all of this work. And so if we just looked at other families at the hospital, our groups would look really, really different, and we wouldn't be able to attribute the difference at the end to just that program, right? Those differences between these groups wouldn't just be from the program, there would be all kinds of other stuff mixed in there, right? So instead, right, because Saoji wouldn't let us flip a coin, and we couldn't just look at other groups at that hospital, we decided to do something that's called matching, okay? And what matching means is that we wanted to go out and find a group of kids who were comparable to this family from Saoji Crianza. And because privacy laws in Brazil are terrible, we were able to do this, okay? So we found another hospital that looked just like, so Saoji works out of something called Hospital Lagoa, and on the other side of town there was Hospital Jesus, okay? And it was the same kind of hospital. It was a public hospital, most of the patients were pediatric, and the head of the hospital was friends with the woman who runs Saoji Crianza. So they let us send a team of researchers into their filing cabinets, basically. So it's 2011 when we're doing this, and nothing is computerized, okay? So you show up at the hospital with your child and he's sick, and you basically fill out a form in this big old dusty book, right? And it gets put on a bookshelf. So they let us go in and take every single book off the bookshelf. And we basically looked at these families for this same five-year period that we were had information on Saoji families for, and we randomly picked out hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these kids, all right? And we were able to get some basic information on them. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a second. But the idea was that we were then able to match, right, based on the age of the child, the disease of the child, and where the kid was from. So basically we knew the kid's name, how old the kid was, what disease they had, and their address. And so we could match on those characteristics, right? So we could find a kid from Saoji Crianza who was 4 years old, had bronchitis, and lived in area A, right? And we could find a kid from this other hospital who looked just like that. And the hope is if we can now find both of them today and interview them, we can get they're comparable, right? And the differences between these kids today should then be attributable to that program. Not just the kids, but the family, obviously, okay? And so that's what we went about doing. And we were able to get, and luckily we got access to this hospital, right? So the whole idea was either a kid goes to Hospital Lagoa, gets Saoji Crianza, and has some status today, and we're going to compare that to a kid who went to Hospital Jesus, didn't get Saoji, and we can look at them today. Okay? And so that's our matching strategy, right? So we basically went out and collected data between December 2011 and April 2012. We had data collection for 170 Saoji Crianza families, so we randomly selected 170 Saoji families out of the 382 that had graduated over the past 5 years. And we took basically 542 names for Hospital Jesus, and we tried to interview them, and that was out of the 1,800 that we picked out of these books. Okay. And we basically had addresses on them, and we sent this survey firm and said, go find them. Okay. And that's how they did that. So we, in the end, collected data on 299 families, 127 from Saoji and 172 from Jeju. And we basically asked them questions in 8 different modules, and I'll get to some of that in a second. So who did we find, right? So we found 100 of the 127 families from Saoji. We found about 75% of them. Of the 172 Hospital Jeju families, we found 31% of them. That's why we threw so many names out there, because we knew they were going to be a lot harder to find, because all we had was an address. Whereas the Saoji families kept in contact, and so we were able to find them a lot easier. Only 2 from Saoji refused the interview, and 5 from Jeju. 9 from Saoji had moved. 36 of the ones we found had moved. 9 of the Saoji children had died, and 6 of the Jeju family had died, and we weren't able to locate 22 Saoji families and 90 of the Jeju families, right? So hopefully, right, what we were able to do through finding these sort of comparable groups was get these two groups that looked really similar, okay? What I would do now, right, if this was a typical sort of paper, is I would show you something, called, usually, I call this summary statistics. Usually, when we do a really good job of randomizing in an evaluation or matching an evaluation, this is called balanced statistics. Because what I want to show you now is that our treatment group, our Saoji family, and our control group, our Jeju families, looked very similar. But they don't look a lot alike at all, okay? And that's really problematic for our study, and I'm gonna explain that a little bit, right? So what does this mean? So on average, our Saoji families were hospitalized 18 days on average, and our Jeju families only 9%. Looking at some other things, so that where there's a real difference. So who completed high school? Only 19% of the adults from our Saoji families completed high school. 34% from our other families did. What this is telling us basically is that the Hospital Jeju families are wealthier, less sick. Okay, and why is that problematic for us? Because they're starting off in a better place. Why did this happen? It happened because we looked at every single kid that showed up at this public hospital. So most of them showed up, they had bronchitis, they got a couple pills, and they left. They never actually stayed at the hospital, right? So we matched on illnesses, but all we knew was respiratory illness. So the kids from Saoji had pneumonia, the kids from Jeju had bronchitis, right? What else did we match on? We matched on basically their zip code, something that's equivalent to a zip code. Why is that problematic? Well, I just told you that story about, right, when you were looking at the World Cup games and you saw them all watching the game on the beach in Rio, and there was fancy houses, and right behind the fancy houses was a favela. It means that a zip code encompasses a huge array of people, from the wealthiest to the poorest, right? And so by just looking at the zip code, we weren't getting people as poor as were in Saoji, okay? So why is this problematic for us? Well, it means that it's going to be really, really, really hard for us to see any difference between these families. So if you're wealthy and you have a health shock, you can muddle your way through, right? Or even if you just have some basic level, right? If you're poor and your kid gets really sick, you can't work and you can't overcome this, right? And so because these families are wealthier, it's going to be hard for us to see where the differences are, right? The good news is there are differences. And what that means is enormous, right? So the fact that this is what these groups look like, and in some cases, I'm going to show you, the Saoji families are doing better than the Jeju families is enormous, right? So these families that were better off to begin with, right, are going to struggle, and our Saoji families with this help are going to do even better in some cases, and in some cases they're going to do worse, right? And so this is just me telling you, we did a really bad job. We didn't do a bad job. We did as best as we could, right? But we weren't able to get a comparable control group. Okay, so in other words, right, I showed you that little picture before. Where we wanted was red dots versus red dots, and if we had gotten that, we could just make this comparison and attribute it to the group, and instead we got red dots and yellow dots, okay? And in doing that, we can still look at the differences and attribute them to the program, but it's going to be a lot harder for us to get significance on these results, okay? So now I want to show you our regression results, and I'm going to show it to you in the 5 different categories. I sort of switched it around. If anybody was in here before, I switched this around. I'm going to show you just some really basic results on these 5 factors, And if you want more information, I have all kinds of cool plots at the end of the talk that I can show you if you want. So first, let's take a look at health. Okay. So our blue figure is always going to be Saúde families, and our Hospital Jesus families are going to be in yellow. So this is the probability of having surgery of the child that we're interested in, right? The child that was sick in the first place. This is the probability that they had surgery or clinical treatment in the last 6 months, right? What this means is either the kid got sick again, or the illness came back, or something like that, right? And families that are better off, right, who are treating their kids who have sort of fewer problems, shouldn't be going and having surgery or any clinical treatments, right? And what do we found? Saúde families are about 10% less likely to have had surgery or clinical treatment in the last 6 months than the Hospital Jesus families. So these families are doing better, right? And if you want, I can show you the statistical significance of these at the end as well, right? This is the probability of having an illness or injury in the last 4 weeks. So, right, so we ask them questions like, you know, did the child who was sick get sick in the last 4 weeks? And that really tells us something about how they're doing today, right? And so we looked at the focus child, that child that got sick in the first place, other children in the family, and adults, right? And so the probability of having an illness in the last 4 weeks was actually higher for our Saúde families, as well as for other children, and our adults were slightly better off than in our control group. So this is total days hospitalized in the 3 to 7 years after they graduated from Saúde, right? So again, we're able to make this comparison, not just for when they graduated, but we're able to see this out over a long number of years, right? And again, the blue bar is Saúde, right? I can't go backwards, sorry. Right? So this is our Saúde families are doing better, right? No matter how far out you go, they're Saúde kids, right? Doing worse, right? The Saúde kids, right, are being hospitalized more often than not, right? And so what does this tell us? It might tell us that the program didn't work, right? It might also just tell us that these kids were a lot sicker in the first place than the other kids, right? So this is distribution of adult mental health, and this is kind of telling, right? So what we did was we gave them these standard, we gave the head of the household, who's, again, often a mother, these standard psychological tests, and we actually find, for how well they're doing. So now I've switched them. This is Jesus over here, and this is Crianza. And I'm not doing it to fool you. I'm doing it because I wasn't paying that much attention, I guess. But Jesus is, again, doing a lot better in terms of just the sort of the well-being that the mother feels, right? It's called the total difficulty index, and it basically gets at how difficult is your life right now, right? And again, we find that 60% of the Saúde families report having much more difficulty with their lives than do the Jesus families, right? And so this is most of our bad news that we're getting here, right? So in terms of health of that focused child, the kids aren't doing as well, though the differences aren't quite statistically significant. This is a big difference. The mental health of the family of the mothers from Saúde is worse than the mental health of the women from Hospital Jesus. What does that tell us? Maybe Saúde needs to concentrate a little bit more on the psychological aspects of their programs, right? So looking at housing, right, I'm not going to show you any numbers here, because what we found on most of our indicators of housing, so we basically did a housing index. So we said things like, do you have a toilet? Are your walls, you know, totally enclosed? Because again, this is for many of them well after they graduated from the program. And so we came up with this sort of housing index. And so in terms of the housing index, some basic statistics that look at the condition of the home: is the floor brick, right? Do you have access to a bathroom? And whether or not they have access to electricity, there's no difference at all between the Saúde families and the Jesus families, right? So normally, that's really bad, right? So if you guys read these, if any of you are econ majors, you know to look for the stars on the graphs, right? So what this is there's no stars here. So normally that's really bad. But because I've told you that the Jesus families are better off to begin with, the fact that we can't see a difference between these families here is great. Right? So what that might mean is maybe Saúde got them up to the level of these other families, right? So no difference is actually a good thing for us here. It's actually pretty good that we're not seeing a difference, right? And so again, for education, we compiled an education index, and we looked at whether school corresponds with age, right? So in other words, if you're 7 years old, you should be in second grade, right? And so we wanted to do is make sure that not just were kids in school, but were they in school for the grade that corresponded with their age? And again, based on this education index, looking at the education not only of the focus child, but the other children in the family and the adults, we find no difference between these two factors, between Saúde and Hospital Jesus. And again, that's a really big deal, right? Because before we would have seen these differences, and we think we can attribute this to Saúde. So looking at income, this is sort of another interesting aspect. So this is the probability of being employed when we interviewed you. And what we find here is about a 10% difference between Saúde families and Jesus families. And that 10% difference is basically Saúde families are about 10% more likely to be employed than Jesus families. And this is for the head of household who we really want being employed, right? This is log of salary from employment. They're pretty similar, right? And what this actually means is there really is no difference between how much they're earning. And then finally, looking at citizenship, we find, again, no difference between a bunch of these different measures of Social Security that Brazil offers and whether or not the teens in the family are pregnant and membership in different organizations. We find no difference between these two groups, right? And so I'm going to show you my little picture, and then I'll go back, even though, right? So just going back really quickly, so we drew this little picture, right? And to us, this is what these results say. I'm going to give you a little qualitative evidence in a second as well, but these are what these results say, right? They basically say that the Hospital Jesus kids got sick, the family got a little bit worse off for a while, and then caught back up to where they were before, right? The Saúde families, the kid gets sick, the family sort of plummets down, does really, really badly. They get Saúde, and they basically move up to the level of the Hospital Jesus families, right? So what it seems like Saúde is doing, right? And we can't be positive because, again, the groups aren't statistically similar, right? Aren't statistically the same. But what it really looks like, based on some positive findings and a lot of null findings, meaning we can't see a difference between these two groups, is that these Saúde families were able to catch up to families that were better off before, just from the program, just from Saúde. And that's a really big deal, right? That really says something about the program. So we also wanted to look at, I'll go over this really briefly so we have lots of time for questions, right? So we also wanted to make sure that we could talk to some people, and that when we talked to them, we wanted to sort of get a feeling for what the program was like. And so we did some qualitative analysis as well. A couple of the things that we did was we just asked them, what's the most important benefit that you received from Saúde? The great majority of them said medicine. 61% said the fact that they were able to give us medicine was the most important benefit. After that, it was emotional support. That monthly meeting that they had with the rich lady from the nice condo overlooking the beach was the next most important benefit to them, right? Just having, knowing that someone was listening to them, right, they believed was number two to medicine, right? Then we asked them what their most difficult obstacle was, and the majority of them again talked about unemployment. And what came out of our finding on this was Saúde sort of redoubled their efforts into creating employment opportunities for these women since this has happened. Then we asked them about the perception of their family well-being, right? And we asked them, and there was a question about this before they entered Saúde, and they basically said, how do you think your family's doing? And so we asked them that again afterwards, right? So 56% of them, when they entered the program, said, our family is doing very badly or very badly. And after the program, only 15% reported doing badly or very badly. Right. So we also conducted a bunch of focus groups where we basically got together a group from Saúde and a group from Jesus who weren't doing so well, and a group from Saúde and a group from Jesus that reported doing a lot better. And we just basically talked to them about what they were doing. And we basically came up with lots of different quotes, right? But to me, the most telling one was this Saúde mother who basically said, joining Saúde was like something great came out of something terrible. Right? Most of the women who came out of this program felt like they were part of a family and had joined this family that took care of them for a little while and then sort of helped them to grow and be more independent on their own, right? And so again, this is what we think the trajectory of these families looks like. So what's the outcome? Well, we found a positive impact on the focus child's health, the other kid's health, and adult employment between these two groups. We found a negative impact on the mental health of the mother and salary, though that was a little bit sort of not that clear, and no impact on housing, citizenship, or education. But remember, again, it's important to realize that we underestimated the true impact of Saoji Crianza because our control group was much better off, right? And that focus group sort of confirmed our suspicions about what was going on with the family, right? So in the end, now, again, you're not supposed to, when you go and do these evaluations, you aren't supposed to be cheerleaders for these groups. But when I went in and I met this organization in the first place and I met the woman who runs it, I really wanted this evaluation to go well because it's just a really, really great organization doing great things. But we really feel that we were able to stay neutral in the evaluation process. And we think that we've come up with some results that really show this trajectory that I showed you, right? That these families, right, who started out so much worse than these other families, who generally hit bottom and then just stay there, are just propelled upwards thanks to this program. So we've got 15 minutes left, right? 10 minutes?
Five.
Oh, I thought we had 50 minutes.
No,
anyway,
okay. We've got a few minutes for questions.
Okay.
Some people might be able to stay. Thank you very much, first of all. At least 5 minutes, and then some people might be able to stay.
Great.
So it sounds like this program takes a lot of money to run and operate.
Yeah.
Which would be like pretty strong urban or strong donors or such.
Yeah.
So the likelihood of being able to replicate this program in other South American countries would be less, since other countries might not have as much money to put into something
with
this much services.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's one of the important reasons for doing an evaluation, right? So because if we get, right, so there's so much money pours into all of these programs that gets wasted every year, right? And because we can't tell if these programs really work, right? I mean, there's a lot of money out there. And right now, because evaluation and randomized evaluation is getting so popular, if you can show that you did an evaluation and you can show that it works, the money is available. In fact, they're talking about, right, so this is, in Brazil they speak Portuguese, and so they don't want to move throughout South America next. The idea is to go to Angola and Mozambique. And there's the Gates Foundation is actually talking to them about starting these programs up in Angola and Mozambique. So yes, it's expensive, and yes, we have a lot of limited resources when we talk about aid, but there's actually a lot that's ready to go into the poorest countries and to hit the poorest people if we can show that it works, which is another reason why this evaluation is so important, right? Yeah.
Isn't it on the money thing? If the cost is so high relative to the family, wouldn't it be better to work on mental health? Since that was the trend that I saw mostly, and it kept bugging me noticing that. Are these mothers like approaching you guys at the hospital knowing that may help her child and family? And if so, isn't that means the mother's motivation is the biggest factor of positive development?
So I told you that we told them the whole thing about we want you to flip a coin, right? We didn't actually just want them to flip a coin. We wanted to have this six-sided coin where either you get in and you get everything, or you just get psychological help, you just get medicine, you just get this. That would be the only way where we could tell what aspect of the program is actually working, right? That's the only way that we could really see that. So we, you know, what does this tell us? It tells us, right, that either Saoji isn't doing a great job in terms of psychological motivation, or, right, these psychological issues are just a lot deeper. I mean, think about the psychological issue of living in poverty, living in a favela, and having a chronically sick child, right? It just kills you psychologically. And so what this says is these women probably need a lot more help in that area. It's not clear that they need that over anything else in the program. Does that answer your question?
I'm curious, what do you think is the greatest factor? I mean, obviously the sick child is the greatest monetary cost.
Yes, yeah.
What do you think is the greatest factor of them developing over time?
I think the relationship between the mother and the volunteer is the greatest thing that the program gives them. I think there's a huge amount of inequality in Brazil, and there's very little interaction between the very rich and the very poor, other than that these people are taking care of their houses and gardens and cooking their food, right? And that's a very different relationship than them sitting down and having a conversation where they say to them, how are you doing? How is your month? Right? These women are showing that they're caring. And right now, we're actually doing a little test to say, not only do we think that that has a huge impact on that family, I think the wealthy women are changing as well. And so we're actually looking at whether their political views are moving more towards the left from being involved in this program, right? So the idea being, they're going to be a little bit more willing to sort of give into Social Security and maybe vote a little bit more towards the left because of their interaction with these people. That's my feeling from it. money for medicine and food and redoing their houses is also huge, right? But I think that that psychological support is enormous. Anybody else?
No, you just said that your biggest focus is on the relationship between politics and
economy. Yeah.
You said that most of these families, hopefully they go out in a few years and fall out of that.
Yeah.
So does that suck? Is that relationship between politics and
economy? No, it never continues, right? So when you graduate, you're done, you don't come back. We followed them, meaning we went back and found these people who had graduated 2, 3, 4, 5 years on, right? Usually, Saoji, I think, every year calls the family, says, how are you doing, gets their contact information, and that's the relationship after they graduate, right? So there is no follow-up, mainly because it would be really expensive, and it's a lot more important to put the money into the families that where the kid is still sick. Yes?
So is there corresponding high incidence of respiratory disease in the adults?
No, right? What these respiratory diseases are happening, and this is actually the reason, the respiratory diseases are the reason that Vera saw this whole thing happening, right? So these kids live in these favelas in Rio, high humidity, there's holes in the walls, there's rats running through, and so they're getting all of these respiratory illnesses. There's fungus all over the walls. I mean, these sort of tin shacks that they're living in, there's, you just see black all up the walls, right? And so the kids get asthma. They get bronchitis based on sort of the non, you know, clean environment that they're living in. Parents, you know, are going to have higher incidences as well, but it really affects children and it affects them into their adulthood as well.
I'm going to those of you who have